I'll generally title it as functions and art.
Okay.
And of course, real valued functions. Okay, so basically what we mean is we are going to look at functions from R to R. Okay. Of course, I will point out a few generalizations also, general metric spaces. Okay, I'll just give you some examples just to illustrate the various ways that functions may be defined. One, of course, is a very simple, straightforward formula which gives to calculate the value at every point. Okay. And then, of course, it may be defined in a very peculiar manner. For example, 1 by x for x not equal to 0 and say some 1 for x equal to 0. So this may be split way of doing it. And there may be a very crazy way of defining the function also. F of x, for example, I can define as 1 when x is rational and 0 when x is not rational. Okay. A more general version of this is, so let A be any subset which we will be using a lot. Let A be any subset of R. Then we define the function f mapping R to R as f of A or f of x is equal to 1 if x belongs to A and 0 if x does not belong to A. Okay. This function is called the characteristic function of the interval or the indicator function of the set A. Okay. Characteristic function. Some people call it indicator function of A and is denoted by, at least I denote it by, though it's a difficult thing to write, is chi AX, okay? Characteristic, so the chi comes there. And some important variations of this function are the following, which will be appearing in our discussions often, are the following. Suppose I be an interval in R, okay, and we look at a function which keeps jumping up and down in a regular interval. Okay, what do I mean by that? So let ij, j equal to 1 to n, be a finite number of disjoint sets, disjoint intervals, such that their union is I. Okay? Then I define f mapping R to R as f of summation alpha j chi I j x j equal to 1 to n, where alpha j's are in R. Okay. So these are step functions. They are constant values alpha j on the interval I j. Okay. So these are called step functions. All these will play an important role in analysis. Okay. And a more general version of this is replace the intervals by arbitrary sets. Okay, so let A be a subset of R, not necessarily an interval, and then A j, j equal to 1 to n, disjoint as a non-empty set such that union j equal to 1 to n, aj equal to a, then define f mapping R to R as f is equal to f of x is equal to summation j equal to 1 to n alpha j chi a j x. So everything, the interval is replaced by arbitrary sets. Okay. These are not now constants on intervals, but constants on some sets. Okay. So these are called simple functions. Such functions are called simple functions. So therefore, from this it is obvious that step functions are simple functions. There these partitions are very special structure, namely intervals. So every step function is a simple function. Okay. Now let me recall the standard definition of a continuous function. That is what I am going to discuss a little bit more. Okay. So let's consider a function from R to R and a point x naught in R. What I mean by saying f is continuous at x naught is, as I approach x naught, the values approach f of x naught. And that is written in the epsilon delta version in various formats. So only one, this is, if f is continuous at x naught, if for any error, there is a control error such that whenever you control the x variables, you will automatically control the value of the function within the error you want. Okay. Which is the same thing as saying limit x tending to x naught of fx equal to x naught. And if the function is continuous at every point, we say it is continuous on R. Okay. If f is continuous at every x not in R, we say f is continuous on R. These are all just recollection of the definitions of continuous functions. Okay. All right. Now let me come here. Maybe there's not enough light. Right, testers. Okay. Now sometimes we will be discussing functions which are not defined on all of R, but only part of R. So the domain may be restricted set in R. So we have to take care of that. So let S be any subset of R. Okay. Now before I talk about continuity and all, I should know what sort of topology I am going to work with in S. Okay. So the topology on R is naturally defined. We have the distance, and that distance define the metric and so on. Now what you do is restrict that distance to S only, to S points only, and then you get what is known as the so-called relative topology on S. Okay. So for every ST in S, define rho ST is equal to mod S minus T, then S becomes, let me call it as rho S, okay. So rho S is nothing but rho restricted to S, okay, only to those points. Rho S becomes a metric space. So therefore, what is an open set in this? First of all, what is an interval in this? For example, if S naught is in S, then interval of length delta in S naught, but now I will say with respect to the set S. So I will keep that in mind that I am restricting all my attention only to the set S. If I did not have this, it is all those point real numbers between S naught minus delta to S naught plus delta. Now I have S. So this is nothing but all the points in S which are within a distance of delta from this, which is the same thing as take the standard regular interval and intersect it with S. So the intervals of S are obtained by intersecting S with the intervals of R. Okay, so intervals, open intervals in S are obtained as intersection of S with intervals in R. So this automatically leads to the fact that the open sets in S are intersections of the open sets in R with S. So open sets in R are obtained as intersection of S with open set in G. So the topology so obtained is called the relative topology. This is called the relative topology. S induced by the topology or not. So every topology on R will induce a corresponding topology on S by taking the intersection of open sets with S. Okay, so that's just like eclipse all those points which are not in S. Okay, that's all. Take open set, eclipse all the points not in S, then what you get is the open set in S. Now obviously this has a generalization to a metric space. If you have a metric space and if you have a subset, restrict that metric only to that subset and you can get all this. Similarly, if X rho is a metric, you can do it in a general topological space also. I am considering only metric spaces. In any topological space, the open sets are given. If you want a subset, intersect them with the open set, you get the relative topology, that's all. Similarly, if X rho is a metric space, S is contained in X rho, then open sets, open balls, B, S, R, A in S are equal to B, R, A intersected with S. Take the regular open ball in the full metric space and intersect it with S. Okay. And open sets in SR, S intersection G, where G is an open set in X. And this is called the relative topology on S. Okay. Now, this definition of continuity, for example, can now be written in any metric space. Okay, replace the mod by row, and then you get the result. So that metric space can be a subset with this relative metric, or a subspace like relative metric in that. So we can talk about continuity of a function defined on any set on a metric space. So in general, therefore, we will make. So all this leads to. We'll come to that a little bit. Okay. All right. Let me write that. In general, we need not even consider real-valued functions. It may be a function from one metric space to another metric space. What this says is, the values can be controlled if you control the variable. Your values can be controlled to any degree desired accuracy by correspondingly controlling the variables. Now, the values are in some metric space, so the control will be with respect to that metric, and the variable is in another metric space, the control is with respect to that metric. So, in general, if x1 row 1, x2 row 2 are any two metric spaces, and F maps x1 row 1 to x2 row 2, we say F is continuous at a point x0 in x1 row 1 if the same thing. For any error control, there exists a variable control such that if we control the variables, so now the variable control is row 1 space and the value control is in the x2 space. That's the general definition of a continuity from one metric space to another metric space. We'll see some quite a few examples little later, but let me put all elementary things first. Now I'm going to look at one other way of expressing continuity, which we will be looking at, namely the following. Let's look at in R. Okay, then the same thing will go. Suppose I have a function from again f is continuous here. Just we say just f is continuous if it is continuous at every point. Okay, this map is continuous if it's continuous at every point. Okay, so now suppose I have a function from R to R and f is continuous. That means if it is continuous at every point. So I have a continuous function from R to R. Okay, so let me draw a picture, though R is not like this. This is R and that's R and F goes like this. Okay. Now take a open set there, G. Okay. So G open, so let G open set in R. You see, by where we write the picture, now we can replace this by one metric space, we can replace that by another metric space. So the same proof will go through. So take your open set in the codomain space. Okay. Now take any point there. Now, first of all, what is its pre-image? That's what we call as F inverse G. So, what is our definition of F inverse of a set? It's all those points in R such that Fx belongs to G. Okay. Take all those points in the domain space which go and fall inside the set G. Nothing may fall. So, F inverse G may be empty. We don't care. we collect all those points in R which go and fall in G, if at all there is anybody. Okay. This should not be confused with the inverse function. This is the inverse of a set. Okay. The inverse function is, unfortunately, it is an abuse of notation. The same notation is used for both. Okay. So now take a point here. That's better. So let X naught belong to F inverse of G. Let me go this way so that we are near the picture. So if X naught is F inverse of G, what is the meaning of somebody is in F inverse of G? Its image must fall in G. So F X naught will fall here. So this implies F X naught belongs to G. Now I am given G is open. Okay. So therefore, whenever somebody is in G and any point is there, he must be an interior point. That means there must be a whole neighborhood which belongs to that. So this implies there exists an epsilon positive such that Fx naught minus epsilon, Fx naught plus epsilon, that whole interval belongs to G because G is open. Okay. So what I have got is a neighborhood here. This is Fx naught, and then I have got a whole neighborhood here which belongs to G. So the obvious, now the metric space proof is the same. Instead of interval, you are trying to open ball, that's all. Now, now since F is continuous, you can control this X naught variable so that the control of F is within this. Okay. There exists a delta because F is continuous. There exists delta greater than 0 corresponding to this epsilon such that X belongs to X naught minus epsilon, X naught plus epsilon implies Fx belongs to Fx naught minus epsilon, Fx naught plus epsilon. What does that mean? Oh, yes. Thank you. So that means I have got now got a small interval about this so that whomsoever you take here, they go and fall here. That means all these fellows are in F inverse G. Okay. That says X belongs to X naught minus delta, X naught plus delta belongs to F inverse of G. So what have I done? Take any point in F inverse of G. We have shown that there exists a whole interval about it which is F inverse of G, which implies X naught is an interior point of G. Interior point of F inverse of G. So every point in F inverse G is an interior point and true for all X naught. True for all X naught in F inverse G. Therefore, F inverse of G is open. Okay. So, what this says is, if we have a function which is continuous from R to R, then the inverse image of any open set is also an open set. Okay. So, what the conclusion is, F maps R to R, continuous, implies F inverse of G open for every open G. Short. Okay. For every open set G, F inverse of G is open. Now the converse is also true. Okay. I will leave it as an exercise. Easy to see that converse is also true. Actually, the we go backwards itself. Okay, so therefore, lemma or theorem or whatever it is, F mapping R to R is continuous if and only if F inverse of G is open for every open G. Now, this is the definition that carries you to non-metric spaces, because this does not involve any metric. It talks only about open sets. So, in any topological space, we can make this. So, in general, generalization, I will look at only metric spaces in this course. I will not go to general topological spaces. F x1, rho 1, x2, rho 2 continuous if and only if. Now, remember that G has to be taken here. So, for every open set in this, its inverse image here is an open set. For every G open set in x2, rho 2, F inverse G is open set in X1, row 1. That's the general definition for metric space maps, continuity map. Okay. So, now that continuity thing is settled, we will look at many aspects of continuity shortly. Okay. Okay, in the course of our discussions, we will be looking at many sets associated with a function. Okay. In particular, for example, we have already seen how open sets behave. This should be very carefully noted. I am saying inverse image of an open set is open. I am not saying F of an open set is open. That's false. F may not take an open set into open set, but F will pull back an open set into an open set. Because if you take the constant function, okay, I will come back to that later. If you take a constant function, what happens? R is open, and it is pulled to a constant, a singleton is a closed set. So, open sets can be taken to closed sets. But therefore, when I say continuity, it doesn't mean open sets go to open sets. I only know that inverse images of open sets are open. In fact, if open sets go to open set, they are called open maps. Okay. Or open. And open maps have some very nice properties. This is another one. Analytic functions are open maps. Okay. In the complex function theory, analytic functions are open maps. Okay, so some sets. Okay, maybe immediately to make one comment here. Does it pull back a closed set to a closed set? So let's say, suppose F is closed in X2, row 2. Therefore, F prime is open. Since F prime is open, its pullback must be open. So, its pullback is open in X1, row 1. If the pullback is open, its complement must be closed. So, F inverse F complement is closed in X1 row 1, and F inverse F complement is just F inverse F. Okay, this is a set theoretic verification. Therefore, F inverse is closed. So, it pulls back closed sets to closed sets, and it pulls back open sets to open sets. We will see later about a few questions. What about this way? Okay. All right, some sets associated with the function. which will all. So again, I look at F mapping R to R. And of course, now that I have stated how this has to be done for a general metric space, you can do that also. Okay, so therefore, I can even take maps from some subset of R to R. There is no need for all of R. Okay, now let alpha be any fixed number in R. See, for example, I can look at all those points where fx has gone beyond the threshold alpha. Or I can look at all the points where fx has just reached the threshold or gone beyond that. Either reached the threshold or gone beyond that. Or fx is below a threshold, or fx as either or below a given threshold level alpha, or all those points where fx is exactly equal to the threshold level I want. So these are various sets that some of the important sets that we will be interested in. Okay. So now, if we look at this, this is nothing but F inverse of alpha infinity. Alpha infinity should be strictly greater than alpha. So F inverse of that interval. This is F inverse of alpha infinity. This is F inverse of minus infinity alpha. This is F inverse of minus infinity alpha. And this is F inverse of the singleton alpha. Okay. And therefore, if F is continuous, it's obvious this is an open set. So pullback is open. This is a closed back. Pullback is closed. Open, pullback is open. Closed, pullback is closed. Okay. If F is open, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If F is continuous, the same story is true for any metric space to R. Okay, so 1 and 3 are open, 2, 4, 5 closed. If F is continuous. If it's not continuous, nothing can be said about these things. Okay. I'm trying to restrict the time for something I want to say. Now, one simple thing I will make a comment about. Such things we will be coming back again and again. Let's take a very simple step function. Say I am up to this 0, then I am something here, then again come to 0. This is a very simple step function. That is, it's constant in this interval, in this 0, in this 0, there is a positive constant. Simple thing like that. So let's say this is A, this is A, this is B. This is obviously not a continuous function. Okay, there is such a big jump taking place at 2 points. Okay. Now, what you do is, there you can do two things. One is look at, let epsilon be positive. Look at A minus epsilon by 2 and B plus epsilon by 2. Okay. Little bit elbow room on this side and a little bit of elbow room on this side. If you provide me that elbow room, then what I will do is, I will join it by a line. So I get a new function. Okay. So I define g of x to be equal to f of x for x in a, a to b, and then linearly, in A minus epsilon by 2 A, B B plus epsilon by 2 and linearly and continuously. Okay. So therefore G is continuous and the set of all points where fx is not equal to gx, the length of that total length is less than epsilon. The only place they are not equal is between here and here, and in here and here, the total length is epsilon. Okay. So what it says is, given a step function, you can approximate it by a continuous function except on a set whose total length is less than epsilon. You can make it as small as you want. Okay. So a step function. This I can do. Suppose I have number of steps. At each step I can make. At each step I can make epsilon 1 by 2, epsilon 1 by 2, epsilon 2 by 2, epsilon 2 by 2, and take the total epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2 plus epsilon n less than epsilon. So you are done. Okay. So a step function, given a step function fx, there exists a continuous, and epsilon greater than 0, there exists a continuous function such that fx is not equal to gx only on finite number of intervals whose total length is less than epsilon. The beauty is, give me a small elbow room, I can make the function smooth. In fact, I can make the function very, very smooth. I can even get an infinitely differentiable function which approximates that. Okay, so in this space, I am able to nicely, smoothly take it to there and merge with it smoothly and then come down smoothly and go like that. I can even do it with a C infinity function. That's I'll probably sometime give that construction simply. Okay. So what this says is, well, then later we will see reasonable simple functions can be approximated by step functions, and step function may be approximated by continuous functions. So essentially, if you know how to handle continuous function, you can at least approximately handle simple reasonable simple functions. Reasonable simple functions lead to what are known as reasonable functions called measurable functions. So any measurable function can be essentially approximated as well as you want by a continuous function. So basically it's cheating. You do everything with continuous function and do it approximately, it's true for that. Okay. Where was it? Right. I want to do something, so I want to keep some time for it. Now I'll do something different. Okay. All this is about continuous, but what if a function is not continuous? How bad continuity can be? In other words, if I say f mapping R to R is continuous, if it is continuous at every point. So I will say it is discontinuous if it is not continuous at some points. Okay. Now, this collection of all these points where the function fails to be discontinuous, can it be very arbitrary, or is there some order in that chaos also? Okay. So the question is, f mapping R to R, okay, I am not saying continuous or something like that. So let us say df is all those points x in R such that f is not continuous at x. Okay. This is called the set of discontinuities of f, the set of points of discontinuity. How bad can this be? How arbitrary can this set be? At the outset, it looks like I can do all kinds of things. What's the big deal? I can make it discontinuous at any type of set I want, and then make it nice in the remaining places. But there is not that much freedom. There is certain structure even in the discontinuities. Okay. This set has a definite structure, and it is one of those sets which we call bare built using open sets and closed sets. It is what is known as an F sigma set. So, I will first write that, okay. Theorem is that DF is an F sigma set. What is an F sigma set? That is a countable union of closed sets. Therefore, it is a special type of Borel set. Because the Borel sigma algebra is the one that contains all the open sets and the closed sets, etc., and countable processes with that and all. So, therefore, the F sigma sets are Borel sets. So, the set of all the set of points of discontinuity is not only a Borel set, it's a very special type of Borel set, namely an F sigma set. And the more important interesting converse, which I will not even touch, is that given any F sigma set, we can construct a function whose discontinuities are precisely that F sigma set. So, the F sigma sets are the ones that control discontinuity precisely. Okay. Another theorem is this. Given any F sigma set, there exists a function F mapping R to R such that the discontinuity set is precisely that given F sigma set. Okay, so there is no other way. You can't just play around with any other set. The discontinuities can be only towards an F sigma set, nothing else. No other thing will work. Okay, probably I will give a proof of this next time, because I want to do it little slowly so that I will not. So, what I will do is I will keep moving with a few more notions of continuity. Then we will see some examples. See, suppose I have F mapping R to R, and then F, what is the definition of continuity? F continuous at X naught. Now I am going to write, if for every epsilon positive, there exists a delta. Now the delta will depend on the error that you want to control, and also it will depend on at the point where you want to control the error. So, the delta will depend on x naught and epsilon such that mod x minus x naught less than delta x naught epsilon implies mod f x minus x naught. Again, in general matrix places, replace this modulus by the metric, okay, the corresponding matrix. Now, if we can choose one delta which works at all the points, then we say it's uniform. I have uniformly chosen one control variable delta which works at all the variables. That is called uniform continuity. If for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists a single delta which depends only on epsilon such that XY belong to R, as long as they are within a distance delta, the values will be less than. The values are also under less than epsilon. Okay, that means one control works at all points. Then we say F is uniformly continuous. Then I will give you some examples next time for all these things. Then F is uniformly continuous. Said to be. I will give you all the versions of all the No, not all, because there are several notions of continuity, some of the notions of continuity. So we are continuous, now at a point, then continuous on R, then uniformly continuous on R. So three notions you have got. On R. So one control works at all the points. As long as you keep two points within a distance of that control, then the values will be within the control of epsilon that you want. That is uniform continuity. There is one more notion called absolutely continuous. That is even worse. Even stronger, not worse. Much stronger notion of continuity. What this says is, I hold two points within a distance delta. Then I am controlling. That's what uniform continuity is. Now, what absolute continuity says is, don't worry about two points. Suppose I have two points here within some control, two points here within some control, two points here within some control, finite pairs, such that the total control is less than delta. Then the value controls also in delta. Okay, so let me write that. Suppose F mapping R to R, if for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0, such that x1, y1, x2, y2, xn, yn are n pairs, a finite number of pairs, with the total difference distance xi minus yi, I equal to 1 to n, let me put capital N, is less than delta. See that gap that's allowed, I am distributing it at different places. What it says is there is one gap that is allowed, minimum gap. If I allow that gap and keep on going over all over the place, I can control in uniformity. Here it says distribute that gap at various places so that the total gap becomes less than delta. Then the correspondingly the distribution of the errors at these gaps is also controlled within epsilon. Then it is called absolutely continuous. Then F is called absolutely continuous. There are other continuities like weak continuous, hemicontinuous, demicontinuous, semicontinuous, and so on and so forth. I will at least look at lower semicontinuous and upper semicontinuous. There are two types of semicontinuity. I will look at them a little later. But I will also introduce another notion, which is a little more general than this, but it does not involve one function, but involves several functions. And that is the one that will come in and to play when you want to look at the collection of all continuous functions, treat that as a metric space and ask what are compact sets in that metric space. Okay, and there is a famous theorem called Arzelà-Ascoli theorem or Ascoli theorem, which will tell you exactly which are the subsets which are like that. Okay. So now, suppose again I have a collection of functions. From R to R. And that collection can be finite. That collection can be countably infinite or uncountably infinite. So, any collection of functions from R to R. Now, if I want each fellow uniformly continuous, means for each fellow I will get a delta. But delta will depend on alpha. Now, if that all dependence can also be removed. For every epsilon, one delta works at all the places for all the functions. Okay, that is uniformly continuous. Okay, that's called equicontinuity. Okay, if now suppose for every epsilon positive, we will see number of few examples of this. Okay, continuous functions, uniform continuous functions, absolutely continuous functions, and equicontinuous. Suppose for every epsilon function, there exists a delta depending on such that mod x minus y less than delta epsilon implies mod f alpha x minus f alpha y is less than epsilon for every alpha. Then the collection is said to be equicontinuous. Of course, the names do not suggest exactly what's happening. Okay, up to uniform continuity, it suggests what it is. That absolutely, maybe it's a bit of arrogance. Okay, and all of them are equally important. The same thing works for everybody else. But that a more better name for that would have been uniformly continuous. Okay, that suggests immediately what the definition is. This notion is important in differentiation and integration theory, and basically the fundamental theorem of integral calculus and the general setup will bring in the absolutely continuous functions. Okay, yeah. Say that? Yes. No, for every such that for is any finite number of points, pairs. For any finite number of pairs, if this holds, okay, these points can be anywhere, the number of pairs chosen can be anywhere. And still, as long as the total gap is less than delta, the total variation will be less than. This is, that's a very important concept that will talk about variation, and that will bring in the functions of bounded variation, the differentiation theory completely depends on that. Okay. So here the n is free, you can choose 100 pairs or 2000 pairs. If you are the more number of pairs you are picking, the gaps allowed may become reduced. Okay, but the total gap is to be less than delta, then that will be less than epsilon. Okay. Any finite number of pairs and at any place you want, x1 may be at that end, y1 may be that end, x4 and y4 may be at this end, but the total gap must be less than delta. Their location is irrelevant, their total number is irrelevant, what is relevant is the total gap. Okay? Okay, that's the next important aspect. There is I will probably recollect a few things, say a few more things. The very important properties of continuous functions, again we start with closed intervals, finite intervals, and then see how it is generalized into compact sets. Okay, so in particular, if f maps this AB belongs to R, that is, if we have a finite closed interval and if I have a function from A to B and f is continuous on this interval, then it has many nice properties. I don't know, most of the things are taught these days at intermediate level, so I do not venture to prove this. Anyway, some things I will prove general when I come to general. One is, such a function will have an absolute maximum and an absolute minimum. Okay, there will be a point and this absolute maximum and minimum are attained. That is, there is a point x0 such that the value of that at that point is smaller than or equal to the value at any other point. And there is a point y naught such that the value at that point is bigger than or equal to the value at any point. So there exists x naught, y naught belonging to AB such that fx naught is less than or equal to fx less than or equal to fy naught for every x in AB. So this is called max f, this is called the min f. So the maximum and minimum exist for such a function. So therefore, this again is basically a bisection argument, okay. That bisection argument, or take an interval, take half of it, take half of it, the intersection of one closed interval contains another, etc. And the diameter going to 0 is always a single point. At that point, m naught, x naught is captured like that. Similarly, that y naught is captured like that. Okay. Therefore, if you now take the values are trapped between these two. Suppose minimum is minus 3 and maximum is plus 4. So, all the other values will have to lie between minus 3 and 4. And the beauty of the continuous function is it will take all the values between minus 3 and 4. That is, the range will be a interval precisely fx naught, fy naught. Okay. That is known as the classical calculus, the intermediate value theorem. That is, if it attains two values, it attains every value in between. In particular, it attains this maximum and minimum, so it attains every value in between. Okay, so the range of f is fx naught, fy naught. That is, every value between fx naught and fy naught is attained. So, putting these two together, the range is also a closed bounded interval. If you have a continuous function from a closed bounded interval, the range is also a closed bounded interval. Okay. And I don't know, some few days back I mentioned about game theory problem. I don't know, all these things will be playing a role in the proof there. Okay. So, therefore, range of f is a closed bounded interval. Now, in the general metric space, we said this closed boundedness has to be reworded carefully, and that's what led to the notion of compactness. So, in the general metric space, first of all, if you have a function from a compact set to a compact to R, then the range will be again compact. But now, what is the role of the interval? Not the open ball or anything like that. Okay, the range, there is a notion of connectedness. Okay, this interval is like this. If you take any two points, let's look at path. Path, there is a path from one to the other which lies completely in that interval itself. I don't have to leave that interval to travel from one point. It's not like our Kaveri agitation. Now I can't travel to even Mysore, leave alone to Hosur or something like that. So we have got disconnected. Okay. That connectedness is the our notion that is there. So if you have a compact connect, if compact sets are taken to compact sets, connected sets are taken to connected sets by a continuous function. So I will at least make the compactness. So, that max and min exists is the one. So, if K is a compact set in x1 row 1 and F mapping x1 row 1 to x2 row 2 is continuous, then f of k, the range of k, is compact
in x2 root.
Compact sets are compact sets, and that is close bounded to close bounded. The same thing is true in the real line. It takes a close bounded set to a close bounded set. So these are some very, very important properties of continuous functions. The connectedness also I'll state. All this will be used so ad nauseum in analysis. Okay, so what I plan to do in the next class is look at the discontinuity set, back to the discontinuity set, and look at quickly for a general proof of this compact set mapping to compact sets. And probably I will introduce the notion of connectedness also and prove that, at least state the theorem of compact connected sets being mapped to connected sets. Okay. Then we will further proceed with our function theory. Okay. Some things about I'll keep my options open. Let's see how it goes. Accordingly, I will develop. Okay. So basically, I'll round up many properties of continuous functions very fast, and then get to something eventually real analysis. Or this is all roughly about before 20th century. Okay. So we are not yet reached 20th century. Then I'll reach 20th century quickly. Okay. Right, I'll stop here.